apparitions. Years since Elvis Presley died, but the arguments about the manner of his death show no signs of abating. In fact, some people insist that he didn't die at all. Many books have been written claiming he died a bloated drug addict, but now we've a special report detailing his last hours with the people who were with him on that night. Our film also shows for the first time the granddaughter he didn't live to see. Steve Dunleavy reports.
Here one night with you.
Elvis the King, Priscilla the Queen Mother, and Lisa Marie Presley, the once rebel princess.
You know how moms are like. Bring home a new guy, they put their foot down.
I put my foot down.
Uh-oh.
And Priscilla did put her foot down, both in this Oldsmobile commercial and in real life.
I mean, they really fought like cats and dogs, mother and daughter though they were, because Priscilla saw her role as bringing Lisa Marie up safely and soundly and not losing her to booze or to drugs or to all of the many temptations.
Mike Walker is the showbiz columnist for the National Enquirer, who has tracked the Presley saga for 25 years, and this week reviewed exclusively a home video of the first time that Elvis's granddaughter, little Danielle, has ever been seen in moving, living color. It was her second birthday party.
This little girl, Danielle, is his grandchild, his heritage, his legacy. I mean, that is the embodiment of Elvis Presley.
You are now getting a rare look at Elvis Presley's grandchild, a sweet little mite who, in her innocence, can't comprehend right now she inherited royalty.
Watching the videos of Elvis's grandchild, it struck me that Elvis would have been spinning in his grave at the kind of party it was.
Perhaps it's a party that you or I might have thrown, but not Elvis Presley.
I mean, Elvis would have rented Disneyland. I mean, that would be the kind of a party that Elvis would have wanted because, you know, this little girl, Danielle, is his grandchild.
Priscilla the Queen and Lisa Marie the Princess now have a new order in their life.
Lisa Marie Presley believes in Scientology, and she was very taken by the fact that when she went on a retreat with members of the church, she suddenly had an out-of-body experience.
Lisa Marie, her mother Priscilla, Lisa's husband Danny Keough, Danny's mother Janet Keough, are reportedly committed to Scientology, a philosophy dedicated to a discipline of life. But what's that? It looks like Lisa Marie drinking what appears to be a beer.
It even shocked me because Lisa Marie has given up booze and drugs after that very difficult period that she went through as a teenager.
But Walker, the veteran Presley watcher, has other thoughts.
There was not a lot of affection there. We never saw Priscilla Presley holding her granddaughter or kissing her. And Elvis Presley would have looked at this party and would have said, hey, this ain't no party. Let's have a party. I see fleets of ponies. I see all kinds of clowns and jugglers brought in. It would have been Minnie Mouse. I mean, Elvis would have rented Disneyland. I mean, it was a very stark kind of a party.
I can't remember if I cried when I read about his widowed bride. But something touched me deep inside the day the music died.
On that day in our time when the music died, a young man was given a new life.
I'm alive today because of this man's death.
His name is Ricky Stanley, and the sands of time in the hourglass of life tell him that he lived in the shadow of greatness, a greatness too huge for a mere mortal to handle.
It was either Elvis or me, one of the two, were going to die because of it. And it happened to him.
He was getting up to go into the bathroom, and he turned around and gave a soft little wave to me.
The beautiful Ginger Alden, the woman who shared his bed with him on that terrible night, the last human being to see Elvis Aaron Presley alive.
One thing really stood out in my mind. I remember he said, I'm not that street out there. You cut me, I bleed.
The blood that pumped through Elvis Presley's veins pumped not only through the veins of a generation, but through history and through legend.
There's no normal woman that can't get excited when he walks on. He's so dynamic.
The phenomena of Elvis Presley's life has surpassed the tragic circumstances of his death. The shrieking headlines about his drug abuse have faded from scandal, and now in this troubled time of youth has become an object lesson.
The shock value is when Rock Hudson died of AIDS. You know, because Elvis died of prescribed drugs, all of a sudden, we could start saying, we got a drug problem now.
But before the problems, Elvis Presley was a textbook of Americana, the poor straw-kicking kid who dared to dream.
He couldn't believe that it was happening. He thought it was a dream. We'd be driving up to Graceland. He would stop halfway up the drive and say, hey, GK, man, can you believe this is really happening?
George Klein was in Elvis's class at school, and they grew up together.
He said, I just hope it's not a dream. And I said, no, man, it's not a dream for sure.
He was a little boy dreamer who wanted other people's dreams to come true.
And I saw him give away as many as 10 Continentals from this very place right here.
He'd buy 10 Continentals and give them away?
10 Continentals and buy them for different employees, different friends, even sometimes complete strangers when they'd walk by.
But Ricky Stanley, the boy who lived because Elvis died, saw the dream heading toward a nightmare as his beloved Elvis sunk deeper and deeper into the morass of prescription drugs.
Elvis couldn't help himself, Steve. Elvis had a dependency upon prescribed drugs, and it's really, really sad.
Even sadder was that Ricky was a hopeless drug addict himself, and the man responsible for delivering the drugs to Elvis Presley the night he died.
Why didn't I have enough guts to look at the man and say, hey, man, you may fire me, you may never want to see me again, but I'm telling you, you're going to be a dead man if you keep living like this.
On August 16, 1977, in a fairy tale house called Graceland, the world mourned Ricky Stanley's prophecy. For the first time, the last moments of Elvis Presley. Ginger Alden awakes at 2 p.m. that day to find Elvis was not laying by her side. She walks to the bathroom.
Elvis?
Frantically, she calls for help. Al Strada, one of the Memphis Mafia.
Elvis?
Elvis!
Joe Esposito, Elvis's road manager, tried to bring life back into Elvis.
I ran upstairs, went into the bathroom, and I saw Elvis laying there on the floor. And naturally, I jumped down there real quick.
Joe went the extra mile. Joe tried everything. Pounding on his chest.
Come on, wait.
Discoloration already set in.
Wait. As soon as I felt him, I knew he was dead.
He'd been dead too long.
The night Elvis died, Ricky Stanley had lapsed into a drug-induced stupor. That morning, he left Graceland to have breakfast.
It was like a premonition or intuition. Something had happened. I walk in, and one of the housekeepers is standing there, and I said, what's going on? What's everybody doing just standing around? And I will never forget that lady looking at me, Steve, and saying, don't you know, Elvis is dead. And the next person I see is a little 9-year-old precious blonde-haired, blue-eyed girl named Lisa Marie. And the only thing she can say is,
he's been dying in the bathroom for and he won't wake up.
Listen, hey, what doctor you get here? I don't care. Just get a doctor here.
They went my mom. I walked through the house. I was in shock. I couldn't believe what I was hearing. And then I see my dad, my stepfather, Vernon Presley.
My boy, and, gone.
Grandma, Elvis's grandmother, Dodger,
my son is gone.
Was sitting there. She was crying. And I just sat down on the floor and cried with my daddy.
As if to defy the laws of nature, and as if to defy the fact that Elvis Presley was mortal, Dr. George Nicopoulos still tried to revive him in the ambulance and again in the hospital.
I couldn't believe that he died. To my recollection, there were four drugs that were found that I had prescribed out of the 12, 13, or 14 that were found in his body. And the others came from who knows where.
There's evidence that would indicate that what's been referred to as a cover-up was taking place, with at least regard to the fact that there had been a regular and significant use of prescription drugs.
The mystery surrounding Presley's death has triggered bizarre theories that range all the way from suicide to murder. But the latest comes from Elvis's uncle, Vester Presley, the gatekeeper at Graceland.
Well, Elvis had bone cancer, and he had several things. He had a bad liver. His mother died with that, but he was taking drugs. The doctors claimed that he wouldn't have lasted as long as he did if he hadn't been drugged up.
People should be concerned more with what Elvis contributed than to what happened in the last years of his life.
On the day Elvis Presley died, Graceland was besieged.
We run over 1 million people in about 48 hours there. They come from all over the world. It was terrible. We had 150 National Guards called in. We had 100 cops from Memphis that helped us for about 2 weeks.
I lost a brother to drugs. Now, I don't know how many people got a
Ricky go. Stanley today is an ordained minister. He preaches to kids about the evils of drugs. He broke his heroin needle, blew away his coke, and burned his pot the night Elvis died.
I can't remember if I cried when I read about his widowed bride.
This is my big brother, and because of his death, it's brought life for me.
The day the music died.
Steve Dunleavy reporting. Well, that's where we'll take a break.